Of our reverence, of our worship. With heaven we lift our voice to praise. We behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, and we see Him seated on the throne. By His blood we've been redeemed. We once were dead, but now we're free, and we praise the King above all.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody, and warm welcome today to our service of morning worship here with the churches of Stanton by Dale, with Dale Abbey and Risley. It's great to have you with us. My name's Phil. I'm the rector of the three churches here, and it's my privilege to be leading the service this morning. Before we say a few hellos to folks, thank you for those of you who've put comments down on the side and greetings this morning. We'll do those in a moment. Just want to begin this morning by reading some words from Psalm number 8. So these are the first four verses of Psalm 8. They say this: Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You've set your glory in the heavens. Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider that your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them, human beings that you care for them? It's incredible, isn't it? Lord, our Lord, He is so majestic. His name is majestic in all the earth. He created everything, even flung the stars in the heavens and space. Yet the Bible is clear that He cares for His creation. He cares for you. He is mindful of you. He knows you. And we meet in that context this morning. We looked at Psalm 8 earlier in the summer, didn't we, when we were looking at how the Psalms offer, show us and teach us how we can have hope, even in the mess of life. Well, let's see who's with us here this morning. I want to say hello to those of you who will be watching on YouTube later on, and to those who are watching via Facebook, but who perhaps can't put comments on for whatever reason. Want to say good morning to Roger and Sonia, and to Ali, Nick and Damien. They were early doors with the messages this morning. And Robin and Merrill, good morning to you. And Ruth's parents, John and Shirley in Swanland, and family friends, Tom and Isabel in Kirkintilloch, which looks like it's sunny. Very good, that's nice. Good morning to Lydia and Simon, much closer to us, up here in Stanton-by-Dale. Good to have you with us. And Zoe and Sydney as well. Good morning to, let me just have a look, Ian Clayton. Good morning, Ian. And Corinne and Adrian too, who send their blessings to Ralph and Sylvia and Glyn and Elaine Warren. It's great, isn't it, to know we're all kind of together, even though we're separated by distance. We've got greetings from the Cousins family, who say good morning to everybody, as does Christine Nolan. Thanks, Chris. And the Groom family, who send their greetings from Risley. Brilliant, isn't it? Kind of like all the... One of the things we really want to keep going with and to grow here is that kind of one church family feeling. Even though we're the three churches, we're one church family. And I suppose that's one of the strong points of having a one live stream for us all, isn't it? Good morning from Pauline Bales. Good to have you with us, Pauline. And from the Holwell family. Just to say, Ed is keeping going with keeping us organised with virtual coffee after the service. So if you would like to join in with that, I'd really recommend it. It's a lovely time. Drop Ed an email, or if you haven't got his email address, you missed it on the slides before, message me and I'll put you in touch. Wow, we've got greetings from Korea, from Michael Cousins. How has he got to Korea? Amazing. To Rachel. Good morning, Rachel. And Mo and Alan Tolson. Good morning to you both. And we've got the Sherwood family. That's a junior Sherwood family. Good morning to you. We've got Jill, Steve and Matthew Hallam. Great to have you guys with us this morning. And Jeff Cook. Glad you're watching, Jeff. And Joan Stapleton in Dale Abbey sends good morning and greetings in the Lord. We've got my kids and Ruth watching us as well. Good morning, guys. And Tom and Nancy Roper. And from Phil and Zoe, brilliant to have you with us as well. So there may well be more folks to say hello to later in the service, but we're going to continue with our service now by saying this opening prayer together. Through the service, the words to respond with will be in yellow on the screen, and hopefully you can see these just here. So let's say this together. Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, direct our thoughts and teach us to pray. Lift up our hearts to worship you in spirit and in truth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, I'm just going to hear a little bit from Jam Club. And over the past about 4 weeks, Jam Club have been thinking about what it must be like for brothers and sisters in Christ who are part of the persecuted church around the world. We're doing this week and next week on it as well. And you'll remember last week was a day, International Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church, and we had a prayer meeting specifically for the persecuted church in the afternoon. But in North Korea, it is against the law to be a Christian. So church meetings usually only involve two people, perhaps, and Christians have to meet in secret places, like in the mountains. If a whole family are Christians, they hold small meetings in their homes. And that is the context for this week's kind of Jam Club, which I'm going to just put on in a second. Now, you'll see I'm under a table. I'm in a kind of secret place. And this week's assignment for the kids is to make a secret church. Have a look and see what you think. Hey Jam Club, it's Phil here again, back under the table. We've got two more weeks where we're going to be thinking about the persecuted church in Jam Club.
And what I'm going to do, I'm going to put on our WhatsApp group two pieces of paper. It says secret assignment on it, make a secret house church. And on that, I just want to say thank you to those of you who were able to do a shoebox that was sent into school earlier in the week. That was brilliant. If you've got another shoebox type box, you could do one of these, make a secret house church. Because in lots of countries, boys and girls and mums and dads and grown-ups are not able to meet freely in their churches. So there's two pages on here, really interesting activity. Also, there's some news coming your way, because in the next 2 weeks, you are going to find out about our next Jam Club, yes, that's right, competition. It's going to be a Jam Club competition you're going to find out about in the next 2 weeks. Not just that, there's more, because your families are also going to get a small gift from Jam Club coming your way too. So watch this space over the next couple of weeks for news about that. See you soon. Bye.
So I want to say thanks to Joel for doing the filming for me for that yesterday. It'd be great, Jam Club, if any of you are able to make one of these kind of secret church kind of settings, do share it on the WhatsApp group. That'd be great to see. And we must continue to pray too, thinking seriously about our persecuted brothers and sisters around the world. That issue is definitely not going away. And one thing, a striking statistic that we learnt last week was that 79% of the world's population lives with some kind of religious restrictions upon them. 79%. It's incredible, isn't it? Let's just pause and pray. We're going to pray for the persecuted church, and we'll pray for Jam Club and also All Sorts. Our group for 15 to 18 year olds is meeting this evening. Let's pray. Father, this morning as we just stop and pause and think just ever so briefly, Lord, about the persecuted church, we pray this morning for our brothers and sisters in North Korea, Lord, that you would keep them safe, that you would help them to keep their eyes fixed on you, the light of the world. Father, we pray for their persecutors, and Lord, that you would thwart their plans and that you would help them to come and find life in the name of Jesus too. Lord, we continue to pray for our children and young people, their families, for Jam Club and for All Sorts, that you would guide and bless the children and young people in those groups. Help them to grow in their love and knowledge of you, even though we're not able to meet together. Give wisdom to their leaders, and thank you for them. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, before we say sorry to God, there's a few other folks just to say hello to. So I want to say good morning to Sarah Gray, and to Shannon and Josh and Willow. Great to have you guys with us. And to Lucy Allen. Good morning, Lucy. And the James family from Dale Abbey. Now, what we're going to do, we come to the part of our service where we confess before our Heavenly Father things that we've done wrong in this week just gone by. We do this corporately. It's a great thing to do each day individually as a follower of Jesus. But it's important that we do it together, showing that we're all in the same boat. We all need saving by the blood of Jesus. And I'm going to say a few sentences which describe different areas where we may have sinned. And I'll say, Father, forgive us. And if you could respond with, save us and help us. So just have a moment of quiet just to think about what's gone on in the week leading up to today. And then we'll pray. God our Father, we come to you in sorrow for our sins, for turning away from you and ignoring your will for our lives. Father, forgive us. Save us and help us. For behaving just as we wish, without thinking of you. Father, forgive us. Save us and help us. For failing you by what we do and think and say. Father, forgive us. Save us and help us. For letting ourselves be drawn away from you by temptations in the world about us. Father, forgive us. Save us and help us. for living as if we were ashamed to belong to your Son. Father, forgive us. Save us and help us. And may the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image, to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song we will praise our God. Amen. Well, our first song this morning picks up on that theme of praising God. It's Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. And in it we sing that if we've put our trust in the Lord Jesus, we've confessed our sins, that we've been ransomed, we've been bought back, we've been healed, we've been restored, we've been forgiven. Wow, aren't those amazing gifts? So we're going to praise him for that. Now, whether you feel comfortable singing aloud at home or not, enjoy this hymn, this song together. Great hymn that is. He's so worthy of our praise, is our God. Now we're going to hear from God's word now, as Sonia brings us our reading again for this week. This week we're focusing on John chapter 1 verses 6 to 8 and 15 to 18, but we're going to hear the whole of John chapter 1 verses 1 to 18 read for us over these 4 weeks, because it's going to be so helpful for us as these words are so rich. So hopefully what you'll hear in the first 5 verses will remind you what we were thinking about last week, and then later in the service Gary Sherwood is going to be teaching us from the verses we're focusing on today. Before we have that, just want to say good morning to Tina, and a shout out for Phoebe James. Make sure I get one especially for her. Brilliant. Okay, so here's our Bible reading again from Sonia.
The reading comes from John chapter 1, verses 1 to 18. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testified concerning him. He cried out, saying, "This is the one I spoke about when I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me.' Out of his fullness we have all received grace, in place of grace already given. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God."
Thank you, Sonia, again for bringing us our reading this week. Now, a few notices to draw your attention to. Firstly, I want to say thank you again to those of you who are able to do a shoebox for this year's Samaritan's Purse shoebox appeal. It was brilliant effort from people doing that in what's quite difficult circumstances this year. And thanks too to the school family at Risley Lower Grammar Primary School. With the church family and the school community, we're able to send over 40 boxes this year, which is brilliant. So thank you very much for that. Couple of other things to draw your attention to. Next week, God willing, we should be able to live stream from the church building here in Stanton-by-Dale. So you may well have to bear with us a little bit with that next week. But it should be that we are able to live stream directly to Facebook and to the phone line at the same time, so that those who don't have the internet can listen in at the same time with those who do. And also, in time, should be able to do that to YouTube as well for those who can't easily access Facebook. So I'll keep you posted on that. But there will be a live stream service next week, 10:30 again in the morning on Sunday. Hopefully from church. If not from church, then it'll definitely be from here. Also, behind the scenes, with the ministry team here, we've been putting together a Christmas magazine that will be ready to be delivered around the benefice. So watch out in your emails for more news about that. And we are planning Christmas services. We're planning to be able to do those. We'd rather be in a position that we can do things if we're allowed, rather than not plan anything and then think, "Oh, yikes, we can do things." So we are planning to be able to do Christmas services. They will look slightly different to years gone by, but more news on that next week. And one other thing, yes, is that on Wednesday night, we're not able to do our kind of normal midweek communion service. So I'm suggesting for any who are free, at 8 o'clock on Wednesday night, we have another informal prayer meeting. There is a lot to pray about at the moment, obviously with all that's going on in the world, but also specifically wanting to make the most of the opportunities to pray about Christmas and things coming up. So if you were around Wednesday at 8 o'clock, I'll send out a Zoom code in the week on our church family email. If you're not getting the emails, do either private message me on Facebook or go to our website and you can contact us through that. Okay, that's all the notices for today. I'm going to lead us in prayer. I'm going to lead us in the collect for today and then hand over to Rob and Helen Groom, who are going to continue to lead us in prayer. So let's pray. Eternal Father, whose Son Jesus Christ descended to the throne of heaven that he might rule over all things as Lord and King, keep the church in the unity of the Spirit and in the bond of peace, and bring the whole created order to worship at his feet, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Here's Rob and Helen.
Good morning.
As the Discipleship Explored course is currently running, which is based around Paul's letter to the Philippians, we'll use some Bible verses from this letter in our prayers this morning. At the end of each section, we'll say, "Lord, in your mercy," and your response will be, "Hear our prayer." So let us pray. Philippians 2, verses 3 and 4 say, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition and vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others."
Lord, as we approach the season of Advent, and as we prepare to celebrate the coming to this earth of your Son, we thank you for your amazing gift, which was undeserved by us, but given by you, because of your great love for the world. Christmas will be different this year, so Lord, we ask that a spirit of generosity and care for others will be in the hearts of people across this country, that we would look out for our friends, relatives, and neighbours at this time. Whatever the government allows us to do, please enable us to be concerned for others more than ourselves. We're thankful for all those helping out in the current pandemic, and we pray especially for our health workers as they care for those in need, that they would find encouragement in their work for the needy. We pray for those who are tasked with planning the mass distribution of vaccines to the population, that they will be perceptive and clear-minded as to the best way forward. Give to all who hold positions of responsibility a sense of common purpose for the sake of others. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In Philippians 1 verse 6, Paul says, "He who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus."
Almighty God, we thank you that you call men and women, boys and girls, to belong to you, and that your people are called to serve you and others in your name. We thank you for the three churches in our benefice, and continue to look to you to lead us and guide us, that we would faithfully represent you in our communities. And we pray for all those who are called to lead us, and also for all those who serve behind the scenes in whatever role, that you will keep them close to you and they would learn increasingly to draw their strength from you. Give all those who belong to you in this benefice the servant nature of Christ, that we would have the same attitude as he. O As we've recently been thinking about the persecuted church, we pray for our brothers and sisters throughout the world, knowing that many Christians are under great pressure and that persecution is happening. Father God, we pray about China and pray for the early rain church, which is suffering repression by the Chinese authorities. And we also pray for your people in Nigeria, in the region of southern Kaduna, where many have been killed by militia. And we pray for your people in Mexico, in the states of Hidalgo and Jalisco, where authorities are pressurizing Christians to renounce their faith in you. Lord, sustain and strengthen those who are facing pressure and persecution, even to the point of being put in prison, or even being put to death for your name. Lord, may they know your power to keep them faithful to you, and may all your people be able to say, as Paul said in Philippians 1 verse 21, "For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Philippians 4 verse 6 says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God."
So God of all comfort, we commend to you all who are anxious or distressed in mind or body. For those who have lost a job or are worrying about the future, or who are finding it hard to make ends meet, those who have problems in a relationship, for those facing an illness or recovering from an operation, or for those facing their first Christmas without a loved one who has passed away during the year, we lift all these to you, Lord. Lord, we pray for any who are feeling lonely or vulnerable at the moment, who are missing being able to mix with friends or loved ones. And we pray for those who are feeling at the end of their tether. We ask that all those who are suffering in any way might know your sustaining presence amidst their pain or distress. And indeed, may they reach out to you in their need. And as we all face the current difficult situation, Lord, in these dark and difficult days, we look to you. Pour out your blessing on our nation, that you may lead us into safety, to the place where you reign as King of all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Amen.
Let's continue in prayer now by saying the words of the Lord's Prayer together. So as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, thank you, Rob and Helen, for leading us in our prayers this morning. And what we're going to do now, we're going to turn to encourage each other by saying the affirmation of faith. We reaffirm the central truths of the Christian faith together. And after we've done that, we're going to hear from Gary Sherwood, who's going to be preaching to us from John chapter 1. So let's encourage each other with these words, and then it'll be over to Gary. Let's say together, I believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Well, good morning and welcome again to my office. Last time I spoke to you, we were in lockdown. And this time I speak to you, again we're in lockdown. Let's pray the next time I do this, it's in church and with you as a congregation. We're going to look at two sections of John in chapter 1, verses 6 to 8 and 15 to 18. They were read to us very well a little earlier. If you have your Bible handy or your electronic device of choice, then now might be a good time to go and get it and to go to John 1, verse 6. So that's the Gospel of John, chapter 1, starting at verse 6. So here we start in this verse. There came a man sent from God, whose name was John. The same came as a witness, that he might testify about the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but was sent that he might testify about the light. So there came a man sent from God, and his name was John. Can you see the contrast here between Jesus and John? We heard last week from Phil that Jesus is the Word, but John is only a man. Just a bloke, as we would say around here. The Word was present with God in the beginning, but John the Baptist was sent by God much later. Each of the Gospels of John the Baptist tells us that he's lesser than Jesus and that Jesus is the greater. So each of the Gospels remind us of this fact. In Mark 1:7, John says that Jesus is more powerful than he. In Matthew 3:14, it tells us that John would have prevented Jesus from coming to him for baptism, saying, "I need to be baptized by you. And do you come to me?" He was sent by God. We must not miss that fact, that John was sent by God, just as Moses and the prophets were sent by God. So then, for all you Bible scholars out there, here's a quick pop quiz. How old was John the Baptist when he first met Jesus? Was he 30? 35? Do you give up? Can't hear anyone shouting. Well, it was naught. Remember, Luke tells of John leaping in Elizabeth's womb when Mary, now pregnant with Jesus, came to visit. And Elizabeth, John's mother, was filled with the Holy Spirit, exclaiming, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. Why am I so favoured that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For behold, when the voice of your greeting came into my ears, the baby leaped in my womb for joy." Luke 1:39-44. So even though John is subordinate to Jesus, God has called him to an important work. A calling that John will complete to the best of his ability. And Jesus will say of John, "Most certainly I tell you, among those who are born of women, there has not arisen anyone greater than John the Baptizer." That's in Matthew 11:11. A key point here, I think, John came as a witness that he might testify about the light. The words witness and testify come from the same root. Both are commonly used in legal settings. In a courtroom, witnesses help to establish guilt or innocence by their testimony. Their purpose is to witness to what they have personal knowledge of, so that a judge or jury can rightly determine the truth. You may know that before my retirement, or as my grandchildren would say, in the olden days, and in my working life, I was a police officer. So from an early point in my career, I got used to giving evidence in a courtroom. In fact, I think I've got a picture somewhere of my first day on the beat. I don't know if you can see it. Yes, I'm old, but I'm not that old. If you've been to court as a witness, or on jury service, or perhaps to answer charges, you'll know that courts operate in a certain way, and the giving evidence is done with some seriousness, involving giving an oath that what you say will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Well, why? Well, usually a lot is at stake, sometimes someone's freedom. In all the times I gave evidence, it may come as a surprise to you, I was never asked questions about me, about my lifestyle, about my church or my vicar, or how I was feeling that day. The only reason I was there was to give evidence about a person or an event or both, not about me. I had to accept that I was the lesser, and that I was giving evidence about was the greater. You know, it's hard to overstate the importance of the words witness and testimony in this gospel. There are many witnesses to Jesus in this gospel. There's the witness of the Father in chapter 5, verse 32. Of the Son about himself, chapter 8, verses 14. The Spirit witnesses in chapter 15, verse 26. Jesus' works witness to him in chapter 5, 36. And Scripture itself in chapter 5, 39. The disciples witness to him in chapter 15, 27. And don't forget the Samaritan woman witnessed to him in chapter 4, 39. And the crowd in chapter 12, 17. So lots and lots of witnesses to Jesus. The book of John is clear that he, John the Baptist, was not the light, but was sent that he might testify about the light. That's Jesus. The gospel makes it clear that John the Baptist is subordinate to Jesus. John was not the light, but sent to testify about the light. The reason for this repeated emphasis on John's subordinate stature is quite simple. At this point in time, John the Baptist is, well, he's famous. He has his disciples and Jesus has his. A source of confusion and possible rivalry. Even decades later, Paul will encounter John's disciples in Ephesus. Disciples who were quite ignorant of Jesus until Paul's arrival, as we read in Acts 19:1-7. John could be seen almost to be in competition with Jesus. Even late in the first century when this gospel is written, the author of the gospel goes to lengths, then both to acknowledge John's God sent by God status and to make it clear that he is subordinate to Jesus. One of the purposes of this gospel is to make it clear what John is not. He's not the light, he's not the Messiah, not Elijah, not the prophet, not worthy to untie the strap of the Messiah's sandal. The author takes no chance of being misunderstood. John is present only to serve as a witness to Jesus. Jesus is and will always be the main character. John has only a supporting role. Now, this model is a good approach for those of us who proclaim the good news of Christ today. Well, why is that? Well, our purpose is not to draw attention to ourselves, but to point to the risen Christ. That doesn't mean that Christian clergy cannot become famous. Just look at Phil, for instance. Well, nearly famous. John was famous in his own right. People from Jerusalem, all over Judea, and all the region around Jordan went out to him, including many Pharisees and Sadducees. But John never forgot that he was sent by God with a mission to point to Christ, and he lived his life in pursuit of that mission. We who have been called by God in modern times need to consider this and remember what our part in this is. To point to Jesus. And to be clear about our witness of events and the person of Christ. In the same way I learnt the lessons of giving evidence in court, we must decrease so that he can increase. Let's move on to the next section, verses 15 onwards. John testified about him. He cried out, saying, "This was he of whom I have said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me, for he was before me.' From his fullness we all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth were realized through Jesus Christ. Noah seen God at any time, the one and only Son who is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him." We have already seen John as the one who bore witness to the light in verses 6 to 8. Now it mentions him again here as bearing witness to the person of Jesus, who is the light. As we saw earlier, John began his ministry before Jesus. So it could be possible to believe that he is senior to Jesus, more important, higher up a pecking order, if you like. No, not so. This section tells us Jesus began his work even before the creation. Remember Phil's teaching last week? So he is prior in both time and preeminent in stature to John the Baptist. From his fullness, he talks about. So to understand fullness, we need to go back to verse 15, which tells us that the Word is full of grace and truth, both attributes of God. Attributes that the Word shares with God the Father, the Father's only Son. It's from this one who is full of grace and truth that we receive grace upon grace. We all receive grace upon grace, and the Greeks charin, anticharitos. This is another, as I would call it, a bargain bucket phrase. Probably best translated grace upon grace, or even grace on top of grace. It tells us that we draw grace from the total resources of God, if you like, an inexhaustible warehouse. As the message puts it, we live off his generous bounty, gift after gift after gift. Just picture the advert for Amazon's biggest warehouse. Multiply that by infinity, and then you just start to scratch God's supply chain for grace. Regardless of our need for grace, and let's be honest, we all need it, the supply is greater, much, much greater. Some years ago, we holidayed as a family in a hotel in Cornwall. The hotel prided itself on its welcome and its good food based on local produce. Towards the end of each evening meal, you could go up to the servery and choose a hot or cold dessert, or as pudding as we call them. Once you collected your ready brimming and sumptuous pudding, an older member of the staff was always there with a large bowl of Cornish cream and a large spoon to place a big dollop of the cream on top of your already dangerously full bowl. Each time you heard the waitress say, "Cornish cream, please," as she happily dolloped it on. No small measures, and a never-ending supply of the stuff. God wants to bless us with his grace. He wants to dollop loads of it into our lives. In verse 17 it tells us, "For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth were realised through Christ Jesus." This is the first mention in this section of Jesus' name. Until now, the identity of the Word has been a mystery. But now the mystery is stripped away and we learn that it is Jesus Christ, the one who brings grace and truth to us. To help people understand God's intent for their lives, God gave the law to Moses and the people of Israel. Jesus Christ took the revelation of God's will to the next level, where all people could experience the fullness of God's grace and truth. It says no one has ever seen God at any time. When Moses asked to see God's glory, God said, "You can't see my face, for no one shall see me and live." Now it is God, the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart, who has made him known. Now, because of Jesus, we can see God clearly. the one and only Son, who is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him. So in conclusion, what needs to be baked into our understanding from today's passage? First, I think we need to be clear about our witness, to point to Jesus and not ourselves, or our minister, or our church. They're all good things. However, only Jesus can and will save the lost. Let's remember the words of John the Baptist later in John 3:30. He, that's Jesus, must increase, but I must decrease. And secondly, grace. As the message puts it in verses 16 to 18, we all live off his generous bounty, gift after gift after gift. So if you're feeling down or unsure in your walk, remember God's grace. Another dollop of it on top of another dollop of it is always there for you. So be encouraged. Never be put off from accepting more of God's grace. Amen.
Gary, thanks for teaching us from that passage this morning. Let's just have a moment of quiet and then I'll lead us in a prayer. Father God, we marvel at your word. Thank you, Lord, that your Son, the Lord Jesus, did take on flesh and come and dwell among us. Thank you that John the Baptist was a reliable witness about that. Father, help us to faithfully witness to him. Lord, may you become greater and may we become less as we do that. May you get the glory and may more and more people in this area and around the world come to recognise who the Lord Jesus is. And Father, thank you that we have good news to share. Thank you, Lord, that you give grace upon grace, dollop after dollop, on your people. Father, thank you that whatever struggles we're going through, the gospel is still true. Thank you, Lord, for that truth. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, the name of the Lord Jesus is a beautiful name. The name of the one who came down from heaven, who took on flesh. He came down, and our next, our final song this morning. What a beautiful name. It might be new to some of you. We're going to reflect on those things and praise God for that truth. So here we are with What a Beautiful Name.
Thank you.
powerful name. It is the name of Jesus. Great to sing his praises. It's been really good to have you joining us this morning from whichever part of the UK you are in. Just a few last hellos as we finish off. I think today is Lydia and Hannah Sherwood's birthday. Sorry I didn't say happy birthday to you earlier in the service, Lydia and Hannah, but I hope you have a lovely day. They're both part of Jam Club. Want to say hello to Kay Chisholm and her family for joining us too. And Auntie Christine, there we go, saying hello to the James family. It's brilliant to kind of connect people from right across the country. And we've got, two groups listening to us from Scotland this morning. So special greetings to you. It's been really good to have you with us this week. Do look out in the week for an email about our kind of informal prayer meeting on Wednesday night. And please do pray that we're able to make the technology work for a live stream from the church in Stanton next Sunday. We'll be with you again at 10:30. Let's close our time formally together now with a prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that you are powerful, that you are beautiful, that you are majestic, as we thought right at the start of the service from Psalm 8. Thank you that you have revealed yourself to us through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Thank you that he is the light of the world and that we have reliable witnesses who have pointed us to him. Lord, may we in turn point others to him and speak so happily and so gratefully of the grace that you pour upon your people. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst us and remain with us always. Amen. We'll see you again soon. With him.